homelessness is what God found when God the Son became incarnate and came to his own, and they did not receive him. He found himself homeless. It used to be that when people didn't have a nice roof to go over their head, that there was plenty of space in the woods where people could freely build shelters. There was open, common space where people could make their homes, and they were often perfectly happy doing that. Those people weren't homeless.
But we were gentle among you, like a nurse taking care of her children.
The world wasn't set up to make homelessness into the massive problem that it is today.
Perform the oath which you swear to our forefathers.
The early church was exhorted to have, for people who did have houses, many, many early Christians, of course, didn't, but for people who did have houses, they were exhorted to have a Christ room. This was an extra bedroom that was available for the stranger who was received as Christ.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and it will be forever.
And this was one primary way, and primary way throughout all of Christian history, that God was met. And so the church has tried all sorts of funny ways to find God, when oftentimes God is right across the street from you or knocking at your door. Some people call us an intentional community, or some people would call us that. I think we're much more of an accidental, ad hoc community. So we have three people living here that used to be on the streets of Durham, and we have become friends with them. When you become friends with people and you have a extra bedroom, you say, of course, come and stay in my extra bedroom. The question, what's up? So the question of what these folks' status is now is largely, I think, something that social workers and the state are concerned with, and we're not all that concerned about that. These are our friends, and these are, in a lot of ways, our teachers. They're sort of the core members of the community.
Annie, how'd you get Roscoe?
I found him in one random parking lot. One random parking lot. He's about 6 months old.
So he followed
me home. Up on at the other house.
Like to sort of have a more
nice street. Interesting. So he followed me home. I've had him ever since.
Protein diet.
Wow.
Yeah.
Right. And so
that's how I got it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That would be something sweet, though.
Yeah. Oh, he's a good dog.
There's no way to agree
with that, though. I don't know. I'm kind of anti-sociable. You feel me? I built log cabins in the mountains in Bean, North Carolina. And I'm doing brick masons and hickory. And bill houses, you know, construction most of my life. Is it on?
Yeah.
Okay, first of all, I like my friend Collins. I like my friend Matt. and I like my friend Gail, and I like Mick, Joe, and Greg, and there's so many other people up there, so I like a lot of people, so I appreciate very, very much what they do for me.
If you do Roscoe, you're never going to leave Elizabeth's house ever.
I just completely forgot about that while I was here.
What's up, buddy?
There is a tension in this house, certainly, as there are in any social relations. Most of the time in friendships, one person is not the patron of another. There are several of us in this house that make money, and several in the house that don't make money, including those who are not formerly homeless. We just have people who have chose to be voluntarily poor.
But she does get...
Of course, there's a sense in which those of us who do make money and therefore support and provide for those who do not are... there's that relationship that needs to be recognized for what it is. On the other hand, we think that it's absolutely wonderful and essential for the salvation of our souls that we have people to give our money to. So in that sense, they are our patrons. They mediate Christ to us by asking us for all that we have and by not ever stopping doing that. Was I expecting this when I came to Durham, or did I have any inkling of what was in front of me? I think the answer is no. When I was doing my MAR at Yale, I was thinking I'll be an academic New Testament scholar for the rest of my life. And then I showed up, and sort of the combination of meeting Stanley Hauerwas and the poor and the daily office and getting involved with the Episcopal discernment process sort of turned that all upside down. We are at Maurin House Catholic Worker in Durham, which is a mission of the Episcopal Diocese of North Carolina. I'm not sure that I have ministry, but this is a community that is devoted to prayer, eating together, simplicity, and fellowship with the poor. Jean Vanier says that a community to survive needs to do three things. They need to pray together, they need to eat together, and they need to celebrate together. And when I read that, I thought, well, geez, that's all we do. We really don't do anything other than that. And so maybe our young community has some hope for the future.
The Lord Almighty grant us a peaceful night and a perfect end.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord,
the maker of heaven and earth.
Let us confess our sins to God. Almighty God, our heavenly Father.
Personalist communitarianism. A personalist is a go-giver, not a go-getter. He tries to give what he has and does not try to get what the other fellow has. He tries to be good by doing good to the other fellow. He is other-centered, not self-centered. He has a social doctrine of the common good. He spreads the social doctrine of the common good through words and deeds. He speaks through deeds as well as words. Through words and deeds, he brings into existence a common unity, the common unity of a community. Better and better off. The world would be better off if people tried to become better. And people would become better if they stopped trying to be better off. For when everybody tries to become better off, nobody is better off. But when everybody tries to become better, everybody is better off. Everybody would be rich if nobody tried to become richer. And nobody would be poor if everybody tried to be the poorest. And everybody would be what he ought to be if everybody tried to be what he wants the other fellow to be.
He said it won't be water, but fire next time. Listen, way back in the Bible days, Noah told the people it's gonna rain. But when he told them, they paid him no mind. And when it happened, they was left behind. I tell you, it's gonna rain. Get ready, it's gonna rain. Lord, you better get ready and bear this in mind. God showed Noah, showed him the rainbow sign. He said it won't be water, but fire next time. Listen, church, they tell me when the water began to pour, they knocked on the window, they knocked on the door, said it won't be water.